All right, I want to continue on in our series of working through this MCA practice quiz, and I want to talk through a couple of the questions 3 and 4. And this particular question is not one that you can put in the answers A, B, C, and D, and then check and see which one fits. You actually have to have some background and be able to figure out what they mean by having a solution here and actually solve and get some solutions for X. So for this particular problem, the background of it is that you have to understand that to get rid of the square root, because before we can go through and solve for X and other things, we have to get it out from underneath that square root. And the property that does that is taking the square of both sides, because the square is the inverse of the square root, and we can then cancel the square and the square root to leave us with just X on the right side. The left side, we multiply that together. That's a perfect square trinomial that would multiply to give you X squared minus 4X plus 4. And now this just becomes a regular polynomial that you have to solve from here. Subtract X from both sides to get X squared minus 5X plus 4 is equal to 0. So this becomes the equation that we now have to solve to figure out how many solutions there are. So just knowing this, we can eliminate D from this list, because we know that a quadratic has at most two real solutions, may have two imaginary solutions, but it's going to have at most two real solutions. So what we have to do is go through and use either quadratic formula or factoring, completing the square to find the answer to this. I'm going to go through and factor it, and the method that I use for factoring is factoring by grouping, where you take the leading coefficient, which in this case is 1, times the final constant, which is 4. And you find the product of that. So you're taking 1 times 4 is 4. And you're finding, of the factors of 4, which factor pairs can you use to get an answer of negative 5? So they have to multiply to give you 4 and sum to give you negative 5. So the factors of 4 are 1 and 4. And 2 and 2. And with this, I realize that I can take and get a negative 5 by rewriting this negative 5 as negative 1x minus 4x. So my two factors, 1 and 4, negative 1 and negative 4, add to give me my negative 5, and they multiply to give me this positive 4. So now factoring by grouping says I factor the first pair, and my greatest common factor there is x, and I'm left with x minus 1. And I factor my second pair, the minus comes down, and my greatest common factor there is 4, and I'm left with x minus 1. Still equal to 0, and at this point my x minus 1 is a common factor. It's that whole group, x times the group x minus 1, and 4 times the group x minus 1, so I factor that x minus 1 out, and I'm left with the factor of x minus 4. So either x minus 1 is equal to 0, or x minus 4 is equal to 0. That's the zero product property, that either one of these factors has to be equal to 0. If x minus 1 equals 0, x would have to equal 1. If x minus 4 equals 0, x would have to equal 4. So potentially there could be two solutions here, but we have to go through and make sure that when we put these things into our original equation, they actually give us valid solutions. So if I put 1 into this, I end up with 1 minus 2, and I'm saying, is that equal to the square root of positive 1? Well, 1 minus 2 is negative 1. The square root of 1 is positive 1, so negative 1 does not equal 1. So this appears to be a solution, but it is not. And then when I come to my second answer of x is equal to 4, I check that, and I go 4 minus 2. Is that equal to the square root of 4? Well, 4 minus 2 is 2. The square root of 4 is also 2. So this one checks, which means there is one possible solution to this equation. All right, for question 4, the big idea on question 4 is the understanding of what is a function. And a function, kind of in just general terms, is when you have a single x that pairs with one and only one y. So when you put x as an input, when you know what x is, there's only going to be one possible output for what y is. Okay? So you can kind of think through these and just go through and imagine what would happen if you put in x's for your value, and could you figure out what y is without a question on it, and there's only one possible value of y. So you can kind of think through it just rationally and try different values of what x is to figure out what your y is, and determine if every single x that you give gives one and only one value of y. If you have a graphing calculator and you're able to put it onto a graphing calculator, then you can look on your graphing calculator and see what the graph looks like. And I have this on my computer here. So I have my four functions into this calculator. So y is equal to x over 5 over x minus 1. And you'll notice here that every single value that I would put into x, other than this value of positive 1, does give me an answer. Positive 1 causes you to have a 0 in the denominator, which is a separate issue called an asymptote. But if I know what x is, I'm going to be able to figure out what y is, and it's only one possible answer. If I look at my other ones here, if I say x is equal to 10, well, it could either be positive 2 or negative 2 as an answer. I don't know if it's going to be 2 or negative 2, because 10 minus 8 is 2. The absolute value of positive 2 is equal to 2, and the absolute value of negative 2 is also equal to 2. So there's two different values of y that could pair up with that positive 2. So because of that, it is not a function, because remember, a function is one x is paired with one and only one y. So if we look at our graph, we can see really easily where this 10 is paired with two different values for y. When we go to our next one, it's the same thing. If x was, say, 5, or actually, yeah, let's say 5, it is either going to be here at positive 1 in something or negative 1 in some decimal number. So we don't know exactly what that y value is, but there's going to be two different possible answers when x is equal to 5. So because of that, it is not a function. And likewise, here when we do y squared equals 4 minus x squared, that gives us a circle, and no matter what x is, if it's between negative 2 and 2, there's going to be two possible answers for it. When x is 0, y is either 2 or negative 2. So the graphs give you a really good idea of what's happening with the function. If you don't understand the graphs, you can just kind of use some of that logic of checking through different values and realizing if a value for x can possibly give you different answers to it. Kind of the general idea that you're looking for, though, is if y is squared, that means there's going to be two different possible x's for it. And that's shown by these graphs, right? When y is squared, there's two different possible values for an x. If y is an absolute value, then you're going to have two different possible values for the y. So the general theme of function, y is to the first power, is a good thing to look for if something is going to be a function. So we can have y is equal to the square root of x, something that is going to be a function. No matter what we put in for x, there's going to be one output for y. Y could be equal to something x squared minus 3x. If you put in a value for x, there's going to be one value for y. So underlying the graphs, underlying everything else to tell if something is a function, a kind of a go-to thing just in general is that if your y is something other than y to the first, probably not going to be a function. So that's just a real quick way to give you a little bit of insight into how to get this answer, even if you don't know exactly what you're looking for on that. So hopefully this helps with these next two questions for the MCA review. I will be back with more.